decide to go Navy instead of the other services?
I grew up in a Navy family. My mother's father went to the Naval Academy, graduated in 1930, became a naval aviator, flew during World War II. My father also went to the Naval Academy, graduated in 1951, became a naval aviator, flew during Vietnam. And so when I thought about the path I needed to take to become an astronaut, it was pretty easy just to go with family tradition and follow in their footsteps and come here to the Naval Academy and go into naval aviation as well.
What are some of the more memorable experiences while you're at NASA?
Oh, I have a lot of memorable experiences from NASA. It's really hard to condense 14 years of working there and a very short answer. I think I should start by saying it had been my childhood dream to be an astronaut ever since watching Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin walk on the moon when I was 10. That had been my dream. I wanted to fly in space. So obviously that first rocket launch will always have a very fond spot in my heart. The first time I got to look out the window and look back at the planet, obviously a very emotional event for me. At that point I realized that all that 25 years of hard work and lots of up and down and blood, sweat, and tears, so to speak, had finally paid off and was living my dream. I got to do some amazing things at NASA. I think some of the more significant experiences I had involved working with the Russians as part of the Shuttle Mir program. As somebody who was commissioned during the Cold War, I never thought I would end up in Russia one day. If I did, it would probably not be for good reasons. But then to suddenly be at the cosmonaut training facility in Star City and working side by side with people that you've trained to go to war with, but now we're friends with, that really was quite remarkable.
Could you talk a little bit about working with the Russians? Like how was
it? You know, once we got past the stereotypes that had been developed during the Cold War, it was really fun getting to know them one-on-one. That probably struck me more than anything, is that when you got to deal with the Russian citizens one-on-one, they were a very wonderful group of people, very warm, very caring. They literally would give you the shirt off their back. Even though they didn't have a lot, they would give it to you. We had several Russian citizens working for us in a small NASA office in Star City, Russia. It's the training, cosmonaut training facility. And we would go to one another's apartments and houses and share dinners together, do fun activities together. So it was really, really quite an interesting experience, like I said, to move past those stereotypes and realize that we were just people and we had a lot in common and we had a lot that we could learn from one another and a lot that we could share with one another and give to one another.
How similar or different is the astronaut corps from like a flight squadron?
Actually, the astronaut office in many ways is quite similar to being in any military unit. Keep in mind that virtually all the first astronauts were from the military. Many of the people who came to work at NASA in the early days of the space program had military backgrounds, and so they brought the military's approach to planning a mission to NASA. They brought that sense of teamwork and camaraderie to NASA as well. So to me, it was a very familiar environment. I was very glad I had gone through flight training, because learning how to fly the shuttle was very similar to learning how to fly some of the aircraft that I flew in the Navy. So yeah, it was a comfortable transition for me. Particularly the fact that you're probably 40% of the astronaut office at the time were military, and people in my astronaut class, one of them was actually a classmate of mine from the Naval Academy, so was comfortable, was familiar, because we had a common background.
How did you want to become an astronaut at first?
Yeah, well, like I said, ever since I was 10 years old, sitting in front of a black and white television growing up in Southern California, when I watched Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin bounce them on that lunar surface, that was it. So yeah, ever since I was 10, that was my dream. And I owe a lot to the Naval Academy, I owe a lot to the Navy for giving me, one, a great academic background, two, a lot of operational experiences. I think that prepared me well to be selected as an astronaut and to then go on and fly 4 shuttle missions.
And what was the moment like when you were first selected, when you first heard you were going to be an astronaut?
I was actually teaching at the Naval Academy at the time, and I was sitting at my office, and I got a phone call, and it was a gentleman named Don Putty, who worked at the Johnson Space Center at the time. And I remember his question quite well. He introduced himself and he said, "Well, I was just wanting to know if you were still interested in being an astronaut, because if you are, we'd like to have you." And I thought to myself, "Am I still interested?" And so I basically sputtered out a yes sir, I am. And so obviously I was elated. Well, the funny part of the story is he then went on to say that, well, your selection has to actually be approved by Congress. We're in the process of doing that, so you can't tell anyone for 24 hours that you've been selected. And I thought, I have this big smile on my face. My office mate, John Ertel, former Marine Corps H-46 pilot, knew what he could tell that this was the phone call. And he looked at me and said, "That's the only time I've seen a helicopter pilot hover without being in a helicopter." But I then asked, I said, "Can I at least tell my parents?" And he said, "Oh, I guess that's okay." But that was a pretty hard 24 hours to keep it secret. But thanks to Professor Ertel, he then proceeded to tell everybody in the physics department that I had been selected. So when I came to to work the next day, there were signs up around that building that I was working in saying, "Congratulations, Lieutenant Commander Lawrence, new NASA astronaut."
All right. How did you think it would be different than the Navy?
Well, you have to keep in mind that NASA is a civilian agency, and so even though, like I said before, about 40% of the astronaut office at that point in time were people who were still active duty in the military, the culture is different. We did not wear uniforms. We didn't refer to one another by rank. And, you know, obviously there was an emphasis on, you know, we had an operational mission, we had to manage risk, similar to what you do when you're planning a mission, you know, when you're going to go fly a flight and you want to understand where you might get in trouble during that mission profile and make sure you have plans to address that. All that was a familiar environment to me. But again, we were at a civilian agency, so we didn't follow strictly military protocol. That sort of world was left behind, but the operational side was still much like what we had done in the world of naval aviation. So that, as I said before, made me feel comfortable because that was an environment that I knew well and was familiar with and knew how to operate in.
Was there a difference in the accuracy that you had to have being in NASA as opposed to being a Navy pilot?
No, I think the approach is very similar. Naval aviation can be an unforgiving environment. You have to know your aircraft, you have to know the systems, you have to know your emergency procedures, you have to have those committed to memory. You have to sit down before the mission and brief it thoroughly. You have to work as a team to be successful. All that is in place when it comes time to fly either on board the shuttle or a mission to the International Space Station. You're a team. Everybody has their own responsibilities to carry out during the mission in order to accomplish it. But we spend a lot of hours making sure we know our systems inside and out, making sure we know what we're going to do in the various situations that we might encounter during the mission, specifically when the system doesn't operate the way it's supposed to. So the approach that I learned in the world of naval aviation, I took with me to NASA. NASA was already using it, and quite well. So like I said, NASA learned a lot from the world of military aviation and still uses it today.
Can you talk about the similarities between a mission with the aircraft and a mission with a shuttle?
Well, the shuttle, it's an aircraft that flies very high up in space, so we call it a spacecraft instead. But it is still put together in pretty much the same way you put together an aircraft, an airplane, a fixed wing, or a helicopter. You've got individual systems on board that work together to allow the aircraft to fly, or the spacecraft to fly. And as an astronaut, you need to know how those systems work, because you have to use them to accomplish your mission. So just like when I went through flight training and I was given an operations manual for my aircraft and I studied it system by system and then went to simulators to practice my procedures, that's exactly the same approach you take as a shuttle astronaut when it comes time to train for your mission. We initially went to single system trainers so we could practice each system one at a time, then went to the motion-based simulator to integrate all those systems. I think the significant difference is the fact that the shuttle was a much more complicated aircraft, spacecraft. I had a 2-inch thick NATOPS manual for my H-46 helicopter. All my manuals for the shuttle were about a foot high when I stacked them together. So the wealth of information that you had to commit to memory was, I think, orders of magnitude over and above that you had to do for your operational aircraft. But again, the skills that I learned during flight training and as a young naval aviator in operational squadrons, those were the skills that I applied as an astronaut.
Was there ever a time where you had to use your training, like something went wrong, you had Houston, you had a problem moment?
Well, yeah, fortunately, I can honestly say that during my 4 shuttle missions, we never really had any significant problems. But during your training flow, your instructor team would throw every problem at the book at you. And so, yes, everything that you'd learned during your NATOPS checks, flying around as a young aviator, practicing your emergency procedures, brought those same skills to the simulator, which more than anything was situational awareness. I think that's the skill that you learn as an aviator to manage your aircraft, to work with your crew, to be aware of what's going on around you as you listen to the air traffic controllers, you're in the landing pattern or you're approaching an airport. That developing that sense of being aware of what's going on around you was really critical to doing well as an astronaut, given the pace of things that can happen on board. So, yeah, I'm really glad that I had that aviation background, because that's essentially what you do. You fly the shuttle. You're a crew member on board that craft, and you have to successfully operate the systems on board in order to accomplish a mission, just like you do on any operational mission in whatever aircraft you flew.
Where do you see aviation going in the next century?
Well, that's a great question, and I hope to listen to the panel this afternoon, Future of Naval Aviation, because I sense where it's headed next is a world of increasing automation. It's amazing what we're able to do with technology now, and you know, as a pilot, you want to be at the controls, but I think that we'll continue to see aircraft develop that don't have the pilot on board. They'll be remotely piloted, or they'll have the aircraft will have the capability on board with its computer software to make its own decisions. So, but it's kind of the age-old question in the world of space as well. Do you send a robotic probe out to explore or a human? Humans have brains. We're really good at problem solving. We're good at being creative when we're faced with a situation that we might not have anticipated. And that skill is not in place yet with robotic aircraft. It's only as good as its software program and who put together the code on board. So hopefully we will continue to see humans involved in aircraft. in operating it and making decisions about how to carry out the mission, because that's a skill that I think we still excel at, bringing the human brain power to bear on the mission and figuring out how to most safely execute it and successfully execute it.
Right. Is there any message you'd like to give to any Navy sailors out there?
Yes. I just had an opportunity to tell this to the midshipmen, but I think the message still applies. When I came to the Naval Academy, it was my dream to be an astronaut. Because of the experiences that I got here at the Naval Academy, I left here realizing I could make that dream come true. And the same goes for the opportunities that I was given in the Navy. I owe a lot to the Navy. I would not have ended up as an astronaut. I would have not had my childhood dream fulfilled without the incredible experiences that the Navy gave to me, and opportunities as well. The Navy offered me an opportunity to get a master's degree at MIT on the Navy's nickel. So what I want to tell the sailors is the Navy can profoundly impact your life. It can make you a much better person. It can give you some opportunities to do things that you never would have imagined when you were a young person. And make sure that you are in a position to take advantage of those opportunities when they are presented to you. And I'll say that again. Put yourself in a position that when that opportunity is presented to you by your command, you can take advantage of it. And try and make decisions as you advance through your career to keep those doors open for you. Because there's some amazing things that you can do once you walk through that door. And it can help you get to where you want to be later in life. It can profoundly impact the direction, as I said. It can make your dreams come true. So the Navy for me was a great place to be. I have a fond spot in my heart for the Navy and the Naval Academy, always will. And I am profoundly grateful for the experiences and the opportunities that they gave to me.
Anything you'd like to add?
I think so.
All right.
Pretty thorough.
Thank you.
As long as the cameraman is-